Hello, I'm James Garner. Listen to a country song and you may hear a fiddle or a guitar or a mandolin. But what you're really hearing is history. The changing sounds that found their way into this century of country. Nowhere can you hear this more than in the music that came out of Memphis in the 1950s and electrified a generation of young Americans. The story goes that a group called the Burnett Brothers were performing one night at a Memphis club. They dedicated a number to their sons, Rocky and Billy, and that, or so they say, is how the music got its name, Rockabilly.
They came from the hills and mountains, the valleys and the plains. Some were kind and gentle, and some too wild and tame.
A string of girlish hearts on an endless ball of twine.
It's the same old train, just a different time. Just a different time.
Can you imagine this world? Can you imagine this world without music? I mean, can you even, I cannot even believe that it could stand. I think it would collapse.
Rockabilly came about because the young country musicians started adapting this jump-type music, a little bit of gospel, a little bit of R&B, some country, and it was just kind of all mixed in together.
There were no I love you love songs. The Rockabillys weren't looking at having the house in the suburbs and the wife and the two kids and the dog. It was all about sex and now, not later, better get it while I can kind of music. And that was very different than what was going on in the culture.
But in the early 1950s, America was ready for something new, especially when it came to country music.
This is the country music capital of the world, Nashville, Tennessee, and the Ryman Auditorium, the Grand Ole Opry.
In Nashville, the Grand Ole Opry had become a powerful force, and its stage was still playing host to acts like Ernest Tubb.
Your letter has cheered me, but I'm lonesome.
The honky-tonk style that was dominating country radio left little room for anything else. But just 150 miles west of Nashville in Memphis, Tennessee, a quiet revolution was taking place. A revolution that would reinvent American music and reshape American culture.
Memphis is a magic place. They have a lot of soul down there. They're not overtaken by, you know, the business of music so much as they are the feeling of music.
Nashville very quickly became a company town, and that was the success of Nashville. The success of Memphis was never to become anybody's town but its own.
Anybody with an idea about how popular music should be played would gravitate towards Memphis because there would be a place for it to be heard.
Memphis is sort of like the roots for people like myself migrating from the South. Most of us stopped in Memphis on our way going to various places. I think various styles of music started from here.
Memphis had a large black community, and at the center of that community was the church. Sunday worship included gospel, black spiritual music that rocked the roof off churches throughout the South. Gospel was soul music, and the clubs that lined Beale Street took that sound and transformed it into rhythm and blues. Clubs that featured R&B artists were colorblind, catering to both black and white audiences.
It's a mistake to think that black and white did not mix in Memphis, you know, pre-Brown versus Board of Education. It was going on all the time, and whites were as welcome in those clubs as anybody else. Country musicians come. Country was always close to blues, and they start picking up ideas from hanging out in the clubs on Beale Street.
Enter Sam Phillips, a high school dropout who studied podiatry and embalming. In 1951, he opened Memphis Recording Service, a tiny hole in the wall that would evolve into the legendary Sun Recording Label. From this nondescript storefront came some of the greatest R&B performers ever recorded. Acts like B.B. King, Ike Turner, and Chester Burnett, the Howlin' Wolf.
I got so intrigued by giving black people an opportunity. I got to know them on Beale Street, because I visited Beale Street before too many white folks did. Loved it.
Sam started recording blues artists, and the word got out in the community that, well, here's a place where we can record and we can start a career here.
You don't love me. You just want to have your way.
He was trying to create something which was quite different than Nashville. They were trying to make a commercial product. Sam was trying to create a unique product.
In 1952, Sam Phillips took a shot at opening a record label of his own. He called it Sun Records. A crowing rooster in front of a rising sun set it off.
I thought it was sort of a symbol of Sam's optimism, his sense of a hopeful future.
I think what happened in the 50s was a complete revolution. The world prior to that had revered the old. All of a sudden, kids had their own clothes, their own music, and more importantly, their own money. So everybody wanted to be youth conscious.
The revolution was spearheaded by men like Sam Phillips and Memphis disc jockey Dewey Phillips, no relation. DJs like Dewey Phillips brought a new awareness to white teens by broadcasting black music on their shows. In Memphis, everyone listened to Dewey and his midnight radio show, Red Hot and Blue.
Dewey Phillips was a pioneer. He was the first one that played stuff on the radio that he loved. Growing up in the 50s was a wonderful thing because the kids had no musical prejudices at all. They loved everything.
You see articles in Cashbox and Billboard about the increasing phenomenon of young white teenagers buying black music and the sense that something is going to happen. Now, what it was exactly, no one was sure.
But America was about to find out.
I've not heard a Sun record that I don't love. Even the bad ones are great.
The year was 1954, and Sam Phillips began searching for a new kind of act. A white artist who had the soul and spirit of a black performer.
He wanted to reach a broader audience. And one of the elements to reach that audience was to find a white artist who could achieve the black feel. And it was really in Elvis that he found the personification of that search.
Elvis Aaron Presley. The son of Gladys and Vernon Presley, poor white transplanted southerners from Tupelo, Mississippi. Elvis was exposed to everything from country music to Dean Martin, but worshipped at the altar of rhythm and blues. Elvis Presley, a shy and soft-spoken truck driver, paid his first visit to Sun Records in the summer of 1953. Sam Phillips wasn't in that day. A part-time employee named Marion Keisker was.
I recall that Sam Phillips had said several times that he wished he could find a white singer with the soul and the feeling and the kind of voice to do the song that were then identified as rhythm and blues songs. It seemed to me that I felt the hair on the back of my neck beginning to prickle some way, and I just snatched up a piece of tape that happened to be lying there and quickly threw it on the tape recorder.
Marion Keisker may have been impressed. Phillips wasn't. He ignored the audition tape for 1 year until he came across a song he wanted to record. Phillips was convinced the song could be a big hit, but he couldn't think of anyone to sing it.
Sam says, you know, I sure wish I could get this song recorded. And I said, what about the boy with the sideburns? And he said, well, I don't know how to get in touch with him. I do.
Man, you talk about one of the purest, clearest voices you ever heard. We didn't have anything on Sun that had made really any noise until Elvis came along, see?
Sam Phillips teamed Elvis with Scotty Moore on guitar and Phil Black on bass. The trio would end up recording a song by blues legend Arthur Crutter.
That's All Right, Mama. When I heard that, it blew my mind because it was so much fun. It was exciting. It was more exciting, say, than most of the country records of that time. I had a lot of echo and a little charm about a little three-piece band.
Well, that's all right, Mama. That's all right for you. That's all right, Mama. Just any way you do, that's all right. That's all right.
The first time I ever heard the record, which was probably in the 70s, I remember hearing it and never being an Elvis fan, not understanding what everybody was talking about, and hearing that record and thinking, I get it, all of a sudden, bang, it wasn't Viva Las Vegas. I suddenly understood why that music could move mountains for people.
Sam Phillips took the newly pressed record over to disc jockey Dewey Phillips, who played it that night on Red Hot and Blue. The audience response was overwhelming. Within a week, That's All Right was creating a stir in the country community. The success of the record encouraged other country musicians to try their hand at something new. Never mind Nashville, Memphis was called.
What killed country music? Elvis Presley killed it. And, you know, he didn't do it with any malice, but he just did it. You know, country music and honky-tonk music could just not compete with Elvis's swinging hips.
Elvis had an unbelievable impact on country music. Oddly enough, he was received well by most of the country music artists. Now, truly, there were some traditionalists that were turned away by Elvis, but for each one that turned away, 10 turned too.
The success of That's All Right was just the beginning for Elvis Presley.
Once we got him on the road, there was something about this dude that I don't think that will ever be explained. You find out in a hurry when you get out on that road and you're trying to sell records what is hot and what ain't. And Elvis Presley was hot.
It was about a year that Elvis and I worked a lot together. We had the same manager. I or whoever he worked with had to open the show. The fellow that went on stage after Elvis went out there to clean it up, and that was it.
July 30th, 1954, just 3 weeks after Presley cut That's All Right for Sun, he made his stage debut in Memphis. Elvis remembered that moment years later when he was quoted as saying, "Everyone was screaming and my manager told me they was hollering because I was wiggling." The Presley phenomenon had begun.
Well, it's probably between the A-bomb and the Model T Ford. I don't know, somewhere around there something happened. Whether America was waiting for it. Elvis had the look, and then the music. It was bound to happen, and it did happen.
I've been very lucky. I happened to come along at a time in the music business where there was no trend. People were looking for something different, and I was lucky. I came along just in time.
Energy. I never saw anybody with that much energy in my life.
It helped that he was so good looking, and he moved so well on stage, and he was real unorthodox with his movements and with his singing, and it was just a whole new world that opened up for all of us teenage girls especially.
And unfortunately, so many of the young girls would yell so loud you couldn't actually hear Elvis. You had to listen to his records to hear him because his live performances were overshadowed by screaming. You couldn't hear him at all.
Elvis was a self-made sensation. He took the pound of James Dean, the dance moves of black musicians, the crooning of Dean Martin, and fused it with R&B, gospel, and country to create a music and attitude that would one day be called rockabilly.
I'm like a Mississippi bullfrog sitting on a holler stump. I'm like a Mississippi bullfrog sitting on a holler stump. I got so many women, I don't know which way to jump. Well,
Rockabilly represents freedom, and it just simply enables you to do whatever it is you feel, and I think that's what it brought to the table for American music back in 54 and 55. Carl Perkins in Jackson, Tennessee, just woke up instantly the minute that That's All Right came out, and almost immediately you had dozens of Elvis's, not Elvis imitators. You could never call Carl Perkins an imitator of anyone, but people who knew where their music could now go.
I tried other record companies sending tapes and couldn't get anywhere, but it was because of him that I really went to Sun Records, because I thought I had a shot at it. I like the same kind of music, you know.
Perkins was a product of the honky-tonks, but he blended that sound with a driving rhythm that broke through the barriers of folksy country and embraced the hard edges of hillbilly blues.
Country is kind of like everywhere, you know, everybody. Being a hillbilly, it had a sort of an independent ring to it. A shit kicker. Carl was just really the epitome to me of the country kind of rockabilly. He really was very special.
Well, I saved enough money, got myself a guitar, had vision of the opera, I'd soon be a star. Picking cotton at day and guitar at night, I got my lessons on the floor by a Cola Light. Wore hand-me-down britches.
Producer Sam Phillips was now riding high with two incredible talents, Perkins and Presley. Then came Johnny Cash.
Now I taught the weeping willow how to cry, and I showed the clouds how to cover up a clear blue sky. And the tears that I cried for that woman gonna flood you, big river, and I'm gonna sit right here until I die.
I hate paths that are beaten. We didn't take Johnny and said, we're gonna make a rocker out of you. When I heard Johnny Cash, it didn't take me long to know that I didn't have, quote-unquote, a potential rocker here, but I had something that was absolutely potentially different.
Cash had grown up along the Mississippi Delta, born and raised on nothing but country music, and he wrote country songs like no one else. A gifted lyricist, Johnny Cash's songs were prose-driven masterpieces.
I've been the husband of one wife, heard my newborn baby cry. But when I've learned enough to really live, I'll be old enough to die. Old enough to die.
He was a storyteller. And there's no question about that. The best I ever heard. I never heard one better.
I had a feel for everyday emotions, things that he saw people around him going through. And he understood his heart. Cash understood his heart really well.
To me, Johnny Cash is country music because he's lived every lyric that a country song has been about.
Cash wrote of the dark struggles of men, and his songs rang with a knowing truth. Folsom Prison Blues sounded so true, many thought it was autobiographical.
Always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns, but I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die.
It wasn't true, but in the eyes of the public, it made Cash larger than life. Thanks to Perkins, Cash, and Presley, the revolution was underway, and a generation of country performers was ready to join.
Of course, I was right there in the throes of all of that, and I happened to be lucky enough to be one of the few females that was doing rock and roll at the time, too.
You gotta plant your feet on solid ground. You can't climb a tree and then...
Brenda was an amazing artist in those days because she was a little bitty thing, Little Miss Dynamite. A lot of people thought she was a small adult, which wasn't true.
Brenda Lee soon graduated from rockabilly to teen stardom and became one of the biggest pop stars that Nashville ever produced. Both she and Elvis would one day leave country music far behind. But for the moment, Elvis Presley was just getting started. On October 2nd, 1954, Elvis Presley was heading from Memphis to Nashville for the Grand Ole Opry. In just 12 weeks, he had two hits on the radio racing up the charts. Despite that success, Elvis Presley still battled enormous self-doubt.
It's sort of a paradox. Here's a man with incredible, unbelievable charisma. He could walk in a room absolutely unknown, and everybody there, men, women, and children, would look at him and be drawn to him, yet he was shy, bashful. Every time he got ready to go on stage, he was shy and nervous. He'd say, "What do you want me to do, Mr. Logan?" I said, "Just do what you do, Elvis. You think they like me?" I said, "I know they'll like you. You just do it the way you normally do it. They'll go for it."
Elvis may have been a force to be reckoned with, but he was up against an even bigger one. Success at the Opry, in his mind, was crucial.
That was a night to remember. Elvis sang Blue Moon of Kentucky and That's All Right, Mama. It was something new for the Opry. It was kind of like, yes, we love him, but do we show it?
Audience reaction to Elvis was less than encouraging. Some even say Opry manager Jim Denny told him, "You better stick to driving a truck." The slick young teen who the press dubbed the Hillbilly Cat returned to Memphis believing he was a failure.
There was a resistance there, but no matter what the professional resistance was, it couldn't stop it. Kids loved that music. They didn't care if it was country or rock and roll or rockabilly. It was their music.
Horace Logan, the Louisiana Hayride's MC, was used to taking in Opry rejects. He'd given Hank Williams a home after the singer was thrown off the Opry for drinking. So when Sam Phillips sent him a recording of That's All Right, Logan welcomed Elvis with open arms.
Would I call him rock and roll, country, or both? I'd call him all of them. He was an entertainer. He never did one song exactly the same as the other, yet you knew instantly, that's Elvis, that's him.
Throughout the fall of 1954, Elvis promoted his second son single. Good Rockin' Tonight was an R&B standard, chock full of sexual innuendo that set the tone for rockers yet to come.
Have you heard the news? There's Good Rockin' Tonight? I just think it's a great song. They've been doing it in rockabilly for years. You know, have you heard the news? There's Good Rockin' Tonight. Meet me, baby, out behind the barn. Come on, sugar, I won't do you no harm. Have you heard the news? There's Good Rockin' Tonight.
Six months after being shunned by the Grand Ole Opry, Elvis was primed for national superstardom. America had gotten a taste of Elvis Presley and begged for more.
This was America, a dream come true. This is what we were taught in school, is try hard. It don't matter if you're poor, you can make it. Now there is a living proof of that. That's what America was seeing. A good-looking young poor boy coming out of a project with an old guitar and a dream.
Well, it's one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready. Now go, cat, go, but don't step on my blue shoes.
Carl Perkins was reaping rewards as well and would sum up the rockabilly movement with his hit, Blue Suede Shoe.
It's one of the signature songs of rock and roll for a number of reasons. For one, youth culture in this country was just beginning to coalesce around the music. And Blue Suede Shoes, because of that cry of go, cat, go, it resonated in young people's lives. You know, from Carl's standpoint, he didn't, for many years, didn't even have a pair of shoes when he was a kid. To people who worked in the cotton fields beside him, owning a pair of shoes was comparable to going to heaven.
I was floating on a cloud. I had a big record. I had me a new Fleetwood, and we moved out of our three-room rented shack and paid down on us a pile of bricks, and them two little children were romping around there. My wife got a new washing machine. I had to be the happiest cat in Tennessee.
Blue Suede Shoes was Perkins' greatest musical moment. The record sold over 1 million copies, but a near-fatal car accident brought it all to a crashing halt. While lying in his hospital bed, Perkins would hear a version of Blue Suede Shoes sung by Elvis, and it was that version that would be remembered by generations to come.
The fact that people think that Elvis Presley is the man responsible for Blue Suede Shoes hurts me, because Carl did it. Carl was right there. He just didn't have the secret ingredient that Elvis did. Carl knew that, and I guess the world knew that. That magic, you can't bottle.
Carl said that, you know, he knew right away when he saw Elvis that even if we're on a par musically, I'm never going to be what this guy is, because this guy's beautiful.
Rockabilly was taking America by storm, and Nashville was beginning to take notice. But the man who brought it to fame was in deep financial trouble. And so, when RCA approached Sam Phillips to sell Elvis's contract, Phillips let go of his spectacular find.
He was deeply in debt when the offer came, you know, to sell Elvis to RCA. He didn't make money off Elvis's records. And he sold Elvis partly to keep the studio afloat.
He's America's new singing sensation, our new RCA recording artist. Here he is, a big reception for Elvis Presley!
It may have been the greatest bargain in music history. Sam Phillips sold Elvis Presley to RCA for $35,000.
Will I find you a place to dwell? Well, it's down at the end of Lonely Street.
The money helped save Sun Records and paved the way for a new rockabilly star who would challenge Elvis as the most audacious talent of all time.
Oh, we're breaking. Whole lot of shaking going on. Easy now, shake.
When it came to talent, Sam Phillips had the Midas touch. Sun Records had threatened the foundation of Nashville with Elvis Presley and Carl Perkins, gave it a run for its money with Johnny Cash, and then unleashed a brazen young rock and roll punk who would shake up country, pop, and just about everyone else.
He was like Rudolph, the red-nosed reindeer. He just stood out like a sore thumb. He romped and stomped rockabilly. He was the piano player when everybody else was playing guitars.
I think with Jerry Lee Lewis, what you see is what you get. He was basically a very, very extraordinary performer. One of my favorite piano players. And when he sang, he just grabbed the song and made it his own.
Yes, this is part of mine.
Jerry Lee Lewis was born to be wild. Raised in a shack in Faraday, Louisiana, his life would mirror his career, tumultuous and out of control. Self-taught, he began playing religious tunes on the piano at age 8, but Jerry Lee was no saint. By the time he was 21, he had been divorced twice, jailed once, and could hardly read or write. The one thing Jerry Lee could do was play the piano and sing. So he traveled to Nashville in hopes of landing a record deal. But Nashville wasn't looking for a Jerry Lee.
It's hard for me to imagine anyone ever turning down Jerry Lee Lewis. I mean, I don't know what kind of a tryout he had, you know, but whatever it was, he didn't make a success in Nashville.
I think they said stuff like, you know, if you could just learn how to play a guitar. But that wasn't what he wanted to do, of course. When he left Nashville, he just went right on to Memphis to Sam Phillips. And of course, when they went through Memphis, Sam Phillips was in Florida on vacation.
Sally, the girl who worked up front, came back and said, she says, there's this guy here who says he plays the piano like Chet Atkins. Oh, to hear that. Send him on in. So he came in. Sure enough, he played Wildwood Flower on the piano. It sounded like Chet. And I said, you sing? Oh, yeah. I sang something. And he sang something, and I loved it. So let me make a tape. When I played the tape for Sam, he said, call him, get him in here.
And the minute I heard him on that little piece of tape that Jack recorded, I didn't know where in the hell that cat was.
Lewis's first Sun record, Crazy Arms, was recorded in mid-November 1956. By December, he was on the radio.
It was so outrageous because when he was singing a country song, he still had that pumping piano and that rocking beat to it.
But the song didn't catch on. To tide the piano pounder over, Phillips hired Lewis to play as a backup musician on recording sessions. It was during one of those sessions that Sam Phillips saw his legacy spring to life.
Carl Perkins had a session. Jerry Lee Lewis, who had just begun recording for Sun, was working as a sideman on Carl's session, and Elvis happened to stop by the studio.
Sam knew he had four great artists right there in front of him, and he, you know, was astute enough to roll some tape after they got started and preserve that one-time meeting of the million-dollar, what became known as the million-dollar quartet.
Oh, what was you playing a while ago, Carl A?
Hey, I don't give a doggone whether people think I'm bragging or not. Thank God I was the one that recognized these people and that they didn't go unnoticed. And that Jerry Lee played the piano, and I wanted that at that time.
Although Crazy Arms didn't quite grab audiences the way Sam Phillips hoped it would, Jerry Lee Lewis's next single blew the lid off modern American music. Whole Lot of Shaking Going On sold over 6 million copies worldwide. Just 8 months after arriving at Sun, the guy who refused to play guitar was showing up on national TV.
He came on with a leopard skin jacket on and hair flopping around, and he pounded the piano, he stood up and he kicked it, and he played with his feet and his hands and his head. We were living in a world of Patti Page, and we'd just come off the big band sound. Perry Como was very placid. He was a wild man.
I remember working with him on a show one time, and a fight broke out in the audience, and he yelled out there and said, hey, the show was up here. Everybody's looking at the fight.
He was so volatile on the stage that the kids actually were tearing the seats out of the floor in the auditorium.
I remember when I played in gospel groups, we'd go to a place to play a concert in a high school. We'd say, we need a piano. They'd say, well, you got to rent one. We go, what, don't you have a piano? Well, we did, but Jerry Lee was here last week, and he jumped on top of it and set it on fire or kicked it off the stage, and I would go, oh, my God.
Within a month, Great Balls of Fire was a huge hit, and Sam Phillips, sure he had found another Elvis, sent his new star on a tour. But Phillips forgot that Jerry Lee Lewis was no Elvis Presley. By 1958, Jerry Lee Lewis was sitting on top of the world. A tour of England was fast approaching, and he was expected to take the country by storm. To celebrate, he brought along his new wife, Myra Gale Brown. It was a move that would bring his career tumbling down. It was hard to know what offended the British more, the fact that Jerry Lee had married his cousin, or that she was only 13 years old.
When he got over there, the English press just made mincemeat out of him. I think they were shocked about the cousin thing and the fact that she was so young. And then the other thing was that there was the little matter of that his divorce wasn't final. So we had the bigamy headlines, we had the cousin headlines, and we had the child bride thing all wrapped up into one.
Jerry, what about this reception in London? Can you tell us about that?
Yes, sir. We had a very good reception, sir.
The papers reported that you were greeted with silence over there and with catcalls from the audience. Is that right?
Well, I can't agree with them, sir. Our audience was very nice and very good.
Mm-hmm. When were you married?
Pardon?
When were you married?
Well, we leave our personal questions out of this, sir.
All right. Well, good luck. Thank you.
Within weeks after his return, Lewis was back playing bar rooms, watching other acts take his place at the top. Two of those acts would take rockabilly to another level. The first was Buddy Holly.
Rockabilly's commercial heyday was very brief, because it quickly mutated into mainstream rock and roll, and guys like Buddy Holly came along who had a solid rockabilly bass, but also a strong leaning towards pop.
If you knew, take it through, then you know why I feel blue without Peggy. My Peggy Sue.
I take it that Buddy Holly was influenced by everything. I bet if we looked into his record collection, we'd find a whole lot of different kind of records. But according to history, and those who were there, country music had its way with Buddy Holly very early on.
Elvis was the king and Jerry Lee the killer. But Buddy Holly was the gentleman of rockabilly music. Holly was born in Lubbock, Texas in 1936, a fan of Elvis Presley. Holly became the first band leader ever to sing lead, compose his own songs, and play lead guitar.
I thought Buddy Holly was one of the shyest men I ever met. I didn't understand why little girls went, ah, when they saw him.
He was first recorded on Decca Records in Nashville by legendary producer Owen Bradley, an architect of the Nashville sound. Bradley was famous for making real stars out of the talent he worked with, but not so when it came to Buddy Holly. The collaboration between the two men was so unsuccessful that it caused Paul Cohen, a top Decca executive, to call Buddy Holly the biggest no-talent I have ever worked with. It took a trip to Norman Petty's studio in New Mexico for Holly to realize his dream.
Well, that'll be the day when you say goodbye. Yes, that'll be the day when you make me cry. You say you're gonna leave, you know it's a lie.
I think Buddy Holly was more traditional, but if you listen to the Everly Brothers, they had complex, wonderful, seamless harmonies. That's very, very professional.
Bye, bye, sweet caresses. Hello, emptiness. I feel like I could die. Bye, bye, my love, goodbye. There goes my baby.
The Everly Brothers. Their memorable harmonies mixed with a country and rock bass made them the number one duo of 1957.
I was into Little Richard, Chuck Berry, Hank Williams, Lefty Frizzell. That combination of music was what I was about, and I liked them equally as well.
I think that the Everly's are as valid as it comes. You can feel just precious harmony, and you cannot beat family harmony. And they're masters of it.
By By the end of the 1950s, the sun was starting to set on Sam Phillips' empire. He had lost Elvis, Jerry Lee Lewis was no longer selling records, and he no longer had Johnny Cash. Angry with Phillips for not letting him record a gospel record, Cash had left Memphis and headed to Nashville to become its premier star.
And it burns, 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 ring the fire.
Sam thought a lot of Johnny Cash. It really surprised me when they split up. I thought they were inseparable.
Not long afterward, Cash asked Carl Perkins to join with him. This would leave Buddy Holly and the Everly Brothers to carry on the rockabilly movement, but not for long. The Everly Brothers were moving beyond rock and roll and embracing the sweet, restrained sounds of pop, and so was Buddy Holly, who was relying more and more on strings to back up his songs. Holly was also performing constantly, trying to keep up with eager fans, excited to see him in person.
I remembered something Buddy Holly told me. We were talking, he said, listen, he said, don't stay around too long. He said, you're going to find several times in your life where you're the hottest thing going or everything's going great for you. Don't wait till it starts fading away. Because he says, if you leave when you're on top, they exaggerate it to the good. Well, they didn't exaggerate it to the good. He was really that great.
February 1959. Exhausted from traveling cross-country in an unheated bus, Holly chartered a plane to get to his next show in Fargo, North Dakota. That night, in a blinding snowstorm, he took off with Ritchie Valens and J.P. Richardson, also known as the Big Bopper. Minutes later, the plane crashed in a frozen field in Iowa, killing all three stars.
My strangest recollection was a conversation we had where he said he had a fear of flying. And that was one thing he didn't like about the entertainment business, that he had to fly.
Buddy Holly's death marked the end of the rockabilly era, although the spirit of rockabilly echoes on.
To this day, if a band plays a rockabilly song in their set, it's amazing what it does to the crowd. It makes them get up out of chairs and start bopping around, you know, and tapping their feet.
Well, the house is rockin', don't bother knockin'. The house is rockin', don't bother knockin'. The house is rockin', don't bother, come on in.
It has a whole bunch of disciples out there in every generation, the same way that bluegrass or country music or jazz does. Rockabilly has its cats and kittens, and they'll always come around. So it's going to live on.
When Sam Phillips founded Sun Records, a new day was dawning in music. And half a century later, the sun still hasn't set. Rockabilly can be heard today in the music of Marty Stewart and bands like the Stray Cats, musicians who've turned back to the roots of rock and roll and rediscovered the raw sound that played such a key role in this century of country. I'm James Garner.
They came from the neon city, suburbs and towns, Wexfield, Baltimore, his sacred holy ground. Drink beer with sparks on an endless ball of twine. It's the same old trains, just a different time. Just a different time. Just a different time. Just a different time.
For more on A Century of Country, visit our website at country.com.